Is there life on Mars? After all, the remains of a dry stream bed and other evidence show water once flowed on the red planet, and that water had the right makeup to support life, as the Curiosity rover found when it drilled below the planet's surface. But we're talking about the past. Could Martian life still exist today? I'm Sophie, and welcome to The Countdown. Well, orbiting cameras have gathered evidence that the planet currently has liquid water. But in order to remain in liquid form, it maintains a high salt content. Far from supporting life, it may be poisonous. On the other hand, some experiments suggest microbes could still survive on Mars. For example, some microorganisms from our planet have thrived in conditions that mimic the Martian environment. And in 2009, an experiment suggested the methane found on Mars could be coming from living organisms. But until we find concrete evidence, we'll just have to keep asking David Bowie's 1971 question.
Is there life on Mars?
At the Large Hadron Collider, particles whiz around a track at incredibly high speeds. So when I heard about ultra-high-energy cosmic rays, which have tens of millions of times more energy than the particles at the LHC, I was impressed. And although these cosmic rays often end by smashing into Earth's atmosphere, we still don't know where they come from. A 2007 study suggests they pick up speed near the supermassive black holes that sit at the center of galaxies. Then they travel from their distant homes to the Milky Way. If that's true, we'd expect to see these rays coming from all active galaxies, including the ones in the Virgo cluster. But these galaxies, roughly 1,000 of them, fail to produce any ultra-high-energy cosmic rays, which means we may have to find another explanation. Perhaps the energetic rays actually originated in the Milky Way long ago, as a 2010 study claims. According to the researchers, when ancient stars exploded in gamma ray bursts, they released atomic nuclei. The high-energy nuclei circled the galaxy for hundreds of thousands of years before finally crashing into Earth. Unfortunately, this model also faces a challenge. Some evidence suggests the rays consist of lone protons, not nuclei, and so the mystery continues. There are several types of supernovae, but perhaps the most useful is type 1A. These stellar explosions are bright enough to act as signposts, called standard candles, for astronomers who want to measure distances. But what causes a 1A supernova? The short answer is a white dwarf. This is a star that has used up most of its fuel and expelled its outer layer, leaving behind its dense core. A type 1A supernova occurs when the white dwarf undergoes a nuclear explosion. Less is known about the cause of that explosion. According to the current model, white dwarfs in binary systems can leach mass away from their companion stars. If the white dwarf gets too greedy, it will grow past a certain point, contract, and then explode. But a 2010 study found that this process may only account for fewer than 5% of type 1A supernovae, which means there must be other culprits behind these explosions. As I mentioned, type 1A supernovae come in handy when you're measuring cosmic distances. In particular, researchers use them to calculate the rate of the universe's expansion. They found the universe is expanding faster and faster in defiance of gravity, which means some other force is causing the acceleration. To indulge their love of cool names, the scientists called that force dark energy. We still don't know exactly what dark energy is. It might be an error in the theory of gravity, or a property of space, or some sort of pervasive fluid. All we do know is that dark energy makes up 68% of the universe's mass. As for the rest of the mass, visible matter only makes up a piddling 5%. So what's going on with the leftover 27%? Scientists have dubbed it dark matter. Dark matter is a mystery of its own. According to the most popular models today, it consists of subatomic particles that interact weakly with visible matter. Several experiments are currently on the lookout for these weakly interacting massive particles, or WIMPs. But competing hypotheses exist as well. How will the universe end? At the moment, it's expanding at an accelerating rate. Will it continue to grow forever, or will gravity pull it back together? That depends on several factors, including the universe's rate of expansion, energy, and density. If the density of the universe is below a certain threshold, then gravity will have little effect. As the universe continues to expand, matter will spread out and cool down until it's unable to support life, an ending called the Big Freeze. And if the expansion speeds up, it may actually tear matter apart in a so-called Big Rip. This fate would pull apart galaxies, then solar systems, and then matter itself, leaving only particles and radiation to populate the remains of the universe. At the moment, the expansion models are winning out. But what if the universe's density is great enough for gravity to triumph? In this case, we get a big crunch. The expansion will slow down and then reverse, causing the universe to collapse in on itself. And some scientists hypothesize that the big crunch wouldn't be the very end. They think the universe may go through a cycle. It expands in a big bang, collapses in a big crunch, and then expands once more, and so on and so on. This model is appropriately called the big bounce. And that's your countdown. What other space mysteries are out there? Let us know in the comments. For Scientific American, I'm Sophie Bushwick.